Okay. Good morning, everyone. I will be chairing today's meeting following the resignation yesterday of Dean Lockhart. We're sorry to see Dean go, but wish him well in his new role and thank him for his service to this committee and for being a courteous and consensus-seeking chair of this committee. And with the agreement of the committee, I would like to write on behalf of the committee expressing our thanks to Dean for his work, particularly in relation to the energy price inquiry, seeing us through that, and obviously our long and continuing investigation into local government and its partners delivering on net zero. Once a motion agreeing the new Conservative member of this committee is agreed, the committee will agree to appoint a new chair at the first opportunity. So we're now in the 23rd meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022. It's our first meeting following summer recess, so it's lovely to see everybody. And if we can move to agenda item one, and we have consideration of whether to take items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Item 3 is consideration of evidence we will hear today. Item 4 is consideration of the committee's work programme, and item 5 we will consider a list of candidates for 2 advisor posts to support our work. So do we agree to take these items in private? Agreed. That is agreed, so items 3, 4 and 5 will be taken in private. Item 2 is our first evidence session in relation to the scrutiny of Scottish biodiversity strategy, and I refer members to the Clark and Spice papers for this item. In June, the committee agreed to scrutinise biodiversity policy and the proposals for the Scottish Government's new biodiversity strategy. It will be the first substantive update of Scotland's overarching biodiversity policy since 2013, and the starting point in a process which will lead into the development of rolling delivery plans and statutory nature restoration targets through the introduction of a Nature Environment Bill. The Scottish Government is currently consulting on this strategy. Consultation ends next week and the strategy should be published later this year. So we're going to hear from 2 panels today focusing on land and marine environments, and the session will be an opportunity to discuss what is needed to address the biodiversity crisis, reflections on the outcomes specified in the consultation, and views on the legislative requirements and what else needs to happen to deliver these outcomes. So I'm going to start with a panel focusing on land, and I welcome our panellists who are all joining us in the room today. Professor Elisa Morguera, Professor of Global Environmental Law at University of Strathclyde and Director One Ocean Hub. Susie Saunders, Policy Advocate, Woodland Trust Scotland. Dr Paul Walton, Head of Habitats and Species, RSPB Scotland. And Bruce Wilson, Public Affairs Manager, Scottish Wildlife Trust. You're very welcome and thank you for accepting our invitation. We're delighted to have you here. So we've allocated around 70 minutes for this, and members will ask questions in turn. And as you know, it will help broadcasting if you can direct your question to a specific person on the panel or set out a running order for answering if the question is relevant to all panels. And so I'd like everyone, members and panellists, to try and be concise in their questions and answers if they can. So I'm going to begin with a question that I will want to put to everybody. I'll come to Professor Morguera first. Scotland has so far struggled to make progress in slowing and reversing biodiversity declines. In your view, what are the key challenges for Scotland and the reason that some targets have been missed to date? And then I will go along and allow everybody in this instance to answer that key question. So, Professor Morguera. I think they'll come to you.
Thank you so much, and good morning, everyone. I think the challenges in Scotland are very much shared by any other country on the globe. All countries are failing in meeting their biodiversity targets, and I think there are some common threats and pressures that every country needs to address. But of course, each country can take more ambitious and more creative approaches to do so, and Scotland has opportunities, I think, to be a leader in certain areas. But I think it's clear that biodiversity is lost because of the large-scale uses of our environment, be that agriculture, be that fisheries, and the fact that we don't give enough consideration to the values, the multiple values of biodiversity in our planning decisions. And those values are really the key, I think, consideration here. And so there's value in biodiversity helping us in mitigating and adapting to climate change, but there's also multiple values that biodiversity plays in relation to our fundamental human rights, to water, to food, to health. And so having that more, I think, more comprehensive understanding of all the benefits for our survival that we derive from biodiversity and how those should then be weighted in decisions on the use of the environment and natural resources in Scotland is really what's needed to change and what can reverse the trend.
Thank you. Susie Saunders, please.
Thank you. So native woodlands are some of our most biodiverse habitats we have in Scotland, and we can't address biodiversity loss without first addressing the decline in the condition of our native woodland. And the decline in the condition of our native woodland comes from a lot of issues, but some of the key issues that we have, and I suppose I would say those are some of the key challenges, are deer, so overgrazing by deer and invasive non-native species such as rhododendron and ponticum. So the Native Woodland Survey for Scotland showed that 50% of our native woodlands are in declining condition because of overgrazing by deer and because of rhododendron ponticum. So we really need to address those key issues if we want to see our biodiversity loss reversed. And we would recommend the best way to do those would be for the committee to recommend Scottish Government that they need to urgently implement the Deer Working Group recommendations and that they need to create a rhododendron ponticum strategy, so a strategy for clearing rhododendron ponticum from all of the UK. One of the great examples of this is Scotland's rainforest. So it's an incredibly biodiverse habitat. It's bursting full of lichens, bryophytes. It's an absolutely incredible place to go to, but it is threatened by things like rhododendron ponticum. I think about 40% of the sites in Scotland's rainforest are impacted by rhododendron ponticum, and it's a really great example of a place where ecosystem restoration needs to happen, and I think if we address those key issues, then we'll hopefully make some progress to restoring biodiversity in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Dr. Walton?
Hi. I'd just like to entirely endorse what Susie was saying there about some of the specifics in terms of key ecosystems, key habitats in this country. Of course, native and ancient woodlands are part of that. But in the wider context, in terms of your question, convener, which is a very good one, you know, why are we failing to halt biodiversity loss? I actually think, broadly speaking, we know what to do. I think the 2004 strategy and its 2020, the strategy 2020 actually was produced in quite a collegiate way. There was big sort of NGO input to it, and also input from NFUS, COSLA, etc. And it was done a sort of cross society. And what was in it was actually pretty good, I think. But the problem was it wasn't implemented and it wasn't funded. So we've seen a big change in the way biodiversity is funded recently in Scotland. So the Nature Restoration Fund, which is £13.5 million per annum for biodiversity conservation, it is unprecedented. But the scale of the challenge is perhaps better illustrated by the Green Finance Institute, who independently estimated £15 to £20 billion is required to actually restore ecosystems, species and habitats and biodiversity, i.e. biodiversity in Scotland. So there's a massive challenge, and I think it is partly about resourcing, it is also partly about the political will to actually make things happen, and critically about mainstreaming biodiversity across government, but also across land use sectors. Mm-hmm. So very broadly speaking, I mean, our network of protected areas, it's not complete, it is not sufficiently well managed, but it's doing quite a lot better than areas outside protected areas. We need to figure out ways to integrate biodiversity thinking across the land use sector, the sporting sector, agriculture, forestry, in a much more effective and constructive way. And I think these are the challenges. And I'm not convinced yet, as we'll probably come on to later, that the current draft is actually sufficient to achieve that.
Okay. Thank you. And can I address that again to Bruce Wilson?
Yep, thanks. I just do the usual of agreeing with everything else that's been said, but I'd probably highlight actually directly what's quoted in the consultation, which is what we have come to understand is that the key shortcomings relating to governance and accountability structures and mechanisms for mainstreaming biodiversity into all areas of policy, including economic policy making, have undermined our ambitions. Too often we're seeing great ambition on biodiversity, but we just don't see that mainstreamed in other policy areas. There's lots of opportunity coming up to do that. We've got the MPF4 final going to be delivered. That has huge impact on how we can not only help biodiversity, but realise opportunity from biodiversity, and then the agriculture bill that will be going through as well. There's huge opportunity to mainstream some of this stuff, but we're going to have to do that. And what I'm not noticing in this consultation, after having just made that statement that's in there, is how we actually achieve that with this Scottish Biodiversity Strategy.
Thank you. And this committee is keen to highlight the importance of the nature crisis and COP15 coming up in particular. So we're going to broaden things out then before we narrow things down again. So maybe staying with yourself, Bruce, going to ask you, what are the current expectations from COP15 in your view? And is the direction of travel from the consultation going to be sufficient to deliver international obligations? I'll put that to everybody before I then ask members to direct individual questions. Bruce?
Well, we've obviously seen some delays with COP15 due to the COVID situation, which is understandable but frustrating, because we are already a significant way into the decade of ecosystem restoration that the UN has set down. So we're starting, you know, from a point of hindrance, and we need to rapidly pick up the pace internationally. And in Scotland, we broadly know that from the COP15 process, we want to make sure that the leaders' pledge for nature, which the First Minister in Scotland has signed up to, which is halting the reverse of loss by 2030, that's something that we hope to come out to kind of get further endorsement from the COP15 process. But again, that 2030 date is, we've not got much time, so we need to act on that. And there's also, coming out of the COP15 process, very importantly, high-level targets. And that is something that I think all the organisations represented here are agreed on, that we need to bring biodiversity up to that level that we have with climate, so that people are focusing on targets. I think that's probably most of the things I would want to see out of the COP15 process at the highest level. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then obviously I want to see that reflected in how we do things in Scotland. It's linked so much to our aspirations around sustainable development goals, the wellbeing economy, mm-hmm. and what was said previously around human rights as well. So it's very important we get that right in Scotland.
Okay, so, and your advice to this Parliament and the committee is really important. So in that regard, so Dr. Walton, and then I'll just come across the panel.
Yes. What we would like to see, I would like to see coming out of COP15 are ambitious, smart targets for nature across the world. And by that I mean targets that are specific, that are quantifiable, that are measurable. And frankly, the prospect of bringing hundreds of governments together to agree such things is massively challenging. There's no doubt about that. And my feeling is that if Scotland waits for those international targets and then entirely judges everything against those, it may well, in practical terms, I hope not, but it may well not be enough to reverse biodiversity loss in this country, because we have seen international targets on several occasions drafted up, be put into international treaties, and then not being met for biodiversity. This has happened consistently. As my colleague said, Scotland can actually be a leader in this. And I would like to see us, of course, look to those targets as some sort of backstop minimum. But in fact, Scotland needs to go quite a lot further. And for that, we need our own smart targets for nature. And those need to be signposted in the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy. And then they need to be put into legislation in the Natural Environment Bill and Act, which are coming in the latter part of this Parliament. And that, I think, is the key route to success.
Thank you. And Susie Saunders?
Thank you. Yeah, I would just like to say, completely agree with everything that everyone's just said. It's maybe a theme of this evidence session, but agree completely on the smart targets, and I think, you know, we don't necessarily have to wait for those to come out of COP15, as you were saying. This strategy provides a really great opportunity for us to set our own smart targets for biodiversity's, for halting biodiversity loss and its recovery. And at the moment, this strategy does not do that. It's just broad sort of outcomes that aren't super clear. And I know we'll probably come on to this in a bit more detail later, but I just thought perfect opportunity to highlight the fact that we can put smart targets in this strategy, and we should, and I can expand on that a bit later. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor McGuire. And then I'll come to Natalie Dawn to start the members' questions.
Thank you. Now, I think the main expectation for this COP is coming up with this global biodiversity framework that can really pinpoint how we can take transformative action. So I think there's a global understanding that incremental change has not helped us reverse biodiversity loss or help enough with mitigation and adaptation to climate change. So the hope is that the global biodiversity framework can give an indication of where transformative action comes from. There's also skepticism that we might get that indication in that framework, partly because of the difficulties of getting consensus among 196 parties. But what is essential, I think, for Scotland, even before that COP, is that that process has identified what has not worked in the past. And I think to make progress in Scotland and elsewhere, we at the very least need to build on what we have learned internationally that has been a mistake in conservation before. One thing we have mentioned already is looking at biodiversity in isolation as opposed to mainstreaming it in other sectors, but that means that biodiversity need to indicate to other sectors what it means to for that to be taken up in, say, climate adaptation or transport or fisheries. We can't expect other sectors to just do that homework on their own. Mm-hmm. But secondly, and I think that's been picked up in the consultation paper, but I think not quite in the right understanding, is that whole-of-society approach. What that means is that, yes, we need government leadership, but that's not enough. We need everybody to work toward understanding the values of biodiversity and contributing, and that means that we have to recognize who's already contributing to biodiversity, and that's missing in the consultation paper. We know that crofters and other local communities, for instance, are ecosystem stewards. There's no recognition of that role at all. And maybe for Scotland as a whole, starting from the recognition of what's working right now is as important as then focusing on what's not working. But also really thinking about not a top-down approach, targets imposed from above and implemented, but really thinking around a process that's bottom-up, and that's, as we were mentioning, based on human rights in terms of a participatory process that brings people in, that makes them see why this is essential to their well-being, to their health, to our survival on this planet. And all of them will recognize the role that they can play. Because what we have seen time and again, I'm working on this across different continents in the world with colleagues, is that every time we set environmental targets without real, genuine consultations and recognition of the roles that some in society already play, we always set ourselves to failure. So we just can't do that again if we really want that transformative change to happen.
Thank you. And that reflects some of the comments we heard in the Edinburgh International Culture Summit discussing climate change of people and nature and that connection. So thank you very much for that. I'm going to move now to Natalie Dawn, and after her, I'll come to Liam Kerr for his questions. Natalie.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. It's nice to have you all here. So we've talked this morning about some of your priorities, and I know that we'll expand a little more on those throughout the session. But I'd like to focus on how you feel that Scotland's efforts to tackle the biodiversity crisis compare with other countries. So what could we learn? Are there instances of best practice? And I think I'd like to come to each of the panel on this, because I think it'd be good to have your different point of views. But I'll start off with Bruce Wilson. I know in the Scottish Wildlife Trust submission, it was noted that Scotland should learn from the experience of other countries and draw on strategies and plans elsewhere, and New Zealand was mentioned specifically. Could you maybe elaborate on those strengths and show how this has proved successful?
Yep, certainly. So we sort of try and, when this consultation was posed, do a little bit of a literature review for examples that we did find. And we particularly liked the work done in New Zealand because it chimed with the First Minister's wording around the wellbeing economy. and how important it is for us to be trying to strive towards that. So in New Zealand, they've tried to base their biodiversity strategy around the four capitals approach. So looking at things like their natural capital, their economic capital, and viewing it in that way. So they've tried to achieve the mainstreaming element by looking at those four capitals as one, and that's what we really liked about that example. I think taking that approach, which the government had previously committed to here in our COVID response, the economic response to that, but it's since dropped down the agenda a little bit in the NZ, in the National Strategy on Economic Transformation. We'd like to see that brought up again. The way that the environment is contextualised within the economic strategy, there are ambitions around the natural environment and natural capital, and we think that needs to be boosted up a level to mainstream through there. That example there would read across as well into our national performance framework. We think we need many more environmental indicators within the national performance framework, and we've seen that happening from a few other places as well. I would actually say as well, there are a few things that we could probably learn from south of the border with regard to implementation. They've taken a little bit of a lead there on how we map our work on biodiversity onto the landscape, and they have things called nature recovery networks. We've got nature networks up here, but we're very much at the sort of discussion stage on those, and that's about delivery, and that is something that I think we could learn from people south of the border that have had experiences there. So yeah, we were impressed with the way that New Zealand has taken steps to mainstream that policy through the biodiversity policy through the rest of their work.
All right. Thank you very much. I'll go to Dr. Walton now, please.
Yeah, the example of New Zealand is a very interesting one. But first of all, I'd like to talk about progress in the European Union, actually. So the EU, some months back, published its own biodiversity strategy, which is actually, you know, broadly speaking, warmly welcomed by the NGO, environmental NGO community. It was quite a consultative process to arrive at it. It was launched on the same day as the EU's Farm to Fork strategy, really emphasising the links between agriculture, which of the five main drivers of biodiversity loss, of habitat change and agriculture as a vehicle of that, is kind of the biggest one across the world and in Europe and probably in Scotland as well. So that integration was achieved then. Now, this is now going to be kind of translated into EU legislation via what will be a regulation, which, I mean, all EU member states have to adopt it, in what is being termed a nature restoration law. And that's just been published, the kind of draft, and it's going through what's called the co-decision process at the moment. But it is really ambitious, and it sets really clear, very specific quantitative targets for nature restoration. And whereas, indeed, the UK government has put targets for nature into legislation, they are, in the RSPB's view, simply too weak, and the EU ones look much, much more encouraging. And I think in the context of the Continuity Act in Scotland, and Scotland's commitment to keep pace with or exceed environmental standards in the European Union, this is something that needs to be looked at really, really carefully. So I think that's what I'd say on the larger scale. Just to get back to New Zealand, one of those five drivers of biodiversity loss is the role of invasive non-native species. Mm-hmm. And New Zealand has absolutely led the world in legislation and public policy around invasive non-native species. And the graph of new non-native species arriving in New Zealand through the 20th century and the century before just rises that steeply. When the legislation came in, the biosecurity legislation, it falls off a cliff. It's the most remarkably successful piece of legislation, a set of legislation anywhere in the world on invasive non-native species. Now, our countries are not directly comparable. We have a land border, for example, but in terms of the size of our human population, it's broadly similar to New Zealand. And I think those examples in terms of invasive non-native species are something that we need to look at really carefully for one of those five big drivers of biodiversity loss specifically.
Thank you. I'll look into that specifically. Susie, I'll come to you, please.
Thank you. So there are a lot of really great examples around the world, but I think there are also some really great examples from within Scotland of sort of people helping biodiversity. So I just wanted to highlight a few. So our native woodland, as I've said before and probably say a lot of times in this session, is one of our most biodiverse habitats, and in particular our ancient woodlands. But they're in really poor condition, and ancient woodlands at this moment in time only cover 2% of our land in Scotland. And lots of facts and figures here now. 43% of those have been degraded by plantations. So one of the best things that we can do to halt biodiversity loss and reverse it is to restore those ancient woodlands, because they have remnants of ancient woodlands within them. So a really great example of where that's happening is a site called Loch Arkaig in the Highlands. So definitely worth looking into. They're sensitively removing non-native conifer species and allowing the ancient woodland to restore there. But in terms of wider ecosystem restoration, I think a really great example of how these efforts in the Scottish biodiversity strategy might look in however many years' time is a site called Glenfinglas that's within the Loch Lomond and Trossachs National Park. So the Woodland Trust acquired it over 25 years ago and have been undertaking wide ecosystem restoration, so woodlands, peatlands, all of those things. And it's now a transformed landscape. I think it's good to look outside of our country, but I think it's also really great to look within our country of examples where nature restoration has happened. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. Things that we're doing that we should be promoting more of nationwide, absolutely. Professor McGuire, I'll come to you, thanks.
Yeah, thank you. Maybe I'll give an example from South Africa, but not about what the South African government is doing, but actually what some of my research colleagues are doing in South Africa that has given already some indication of transformative change. And that has been really using research funding to create partnerships where researchers from across marine and social sciences and the arts are working with local communities, NGOs, and local government to bring knowledge together. So really to understand what locally we know about nature and biodiversity and climate change, together with the knowledge that's already within government, and co-develop solutions. And then find through that an approach that addresses also local needs and justice issues. And I think that what is incredible in that is that it sounds very complex, and it is, but it really helps integrated thinking, which is what usually makes us fall short in our efforts to effectively conserve or use sustainably biodiversity. And we think that joined up thinking, again, can come from above, but in fact, it's the local level where you live and breathe that complexity. And so linking that knowledge and asking researchers to help in that process has really been quite transformative in South Africa, and very complex issues related to offshore energy and protection of the ocean and protection of very distinctive cultural connections to the ocean. And so I think there's an element there that speaks to both funding, but also the opportunity for Scotland, such an incredible, vibrant community of researchers here that has done a lot of pioneering work on ecosystem services, for instance, to work together to implement the strategy. And really moving away, I think, from the current understanding in the draft around delivery partners. So we talk about local communities, NGOs, researchers as delivery partners, whereas what we should be looking at is co-development of solutions. We're all partners in understanding what the solutions are and working out how we can bring them forward. So that's a different thinking around who's going to do the work, how we can do it together, and putting the funding into that which is research and practice at the same time. Because the reality is that transformative change is a learning process. We don't know how that will work. We learn as we go. And so we need to put resources and support for all actors involved in that continuous learning and learning from each other.
Thank you. I realised that question. I think we could probably spend the whole committee talking about different examples of good practice, but it's important to hear some of the things that you think are best going on internationally and at home. I'll pass back to the convener.
Thank you. I'll come to Liam Kerr and then I'll come to Mark after that.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. I'll direct my first question to Professor Morgera and then Bruce Wilson, as Bruce, you specifically referred to the limitations of previous strategies for governance and accountability in your submission. There is a section on conditions for success, And one of those conditions is to have an independent body to monitor and report on progress alongside an independent and improved monitoring framework. But it doesn't then go on to say anything about what those look like. So do you have a view on what's currently in place and what these solutions as regards monitoring and reporting might look like for the best? Professor Morghera.
Internationally has been an ongoing question how we best monitor. I think, I mean, there's a precondition to that which was mentioned by my colleagues earlier on, which is unless we have measurable targets, we can't monitor. And so that's the first question. At the moment, we have no measurable target proposed and no baseline. The second is that we already have a new environmental watchdog in Scotland. We have environmental standards. And I guess the question is, the first question would be, can that body do this work or do we need another one? I think it's important to look at what we have. But then I think that the other, issue that's really important is that, again, monitoring shouldn't just be a tick box or a compliance exercise. It should really be a learning exercise, because the reality is that transformative change is difficult and we'll make mistakes along the way, but as long as that is all an opportunity for learning and doing better and increasing understanding, then that is really what's worth investing in. And so I think thinking around a process for monitoring and sharing the learning, which is something we discussed also in the context of Scotland's ambition as a human rights leader, which is very much linked to the environment and what we can do for climate change and biodiversity, I think is a key component of that.
Very grateful. Bruce Wilson.
I mean, I think for me, the targets that drive this are absolutely essential. We don't really have any real compulsion for public bodies or others to be contributing towards this at the moment, other than just the goodwill to do so. We already have a requirement for public bodies to report on their biodiversity duty, but that's quite poorly worded. There's no real guidance that goes along with that to help people understand what they need to report on. So we often see people submitting carbon data or you know, information about programs they've got to turn off lights, which is all laudable and nice, but is not really directly tackling the biodiversity crisis that we would like to see. So we need a rapid upskilling of people across sectors to understand how their impacts and dependencies on biodiversity within organisations and as a country, as well as linked to these strong targets that we've already mentioned. I'd probably add as well that you can't really manage effectively what you don't measure, and we don't measure adequately biodiversity in Scotland at the moment. Data is a massive issue, and we need to get on top of that data issue. It's more complex than climate in many ways, and we've got a lot of dedicated citizen science projects, but we also need to be making sure that we are fully getting the best out of private sector information and making sure the kind of pathways for that data to get to where it can be useful are properly maintained. At the moment, the comparison I've heard from colleagues is it's basically held together with sticky tape, and that needs to improve. There's recommendations from the Scottish Biodiversity Information Forum that we need to properly implement. Paul's probably got a little bit to say on data, I imagine, as well.
I'll throw the next question to Dr. Walton, actually, so if you want to wrap that up in your answer there. But my follow-up question is a bit about funding in the conditions for success, but there are no real thoughts on the sources of that funding, bar a reference to agricultural subsidies. Now, Bruce Wilson, your submission says funding is not on the scale that's required. And Dr. Walton, in your opening remarks, you referred to the same thing. So, Dr. Walton first, and then Bruce Wilson, can you give the committee an idea of the scale of funding that you think is required? Is the consultation realistic around this? And what would you expect to see in a delivery plan as regards funding?
Okay. First of all, to wrap up the previous question, which is targets, absolutely, we are of one on this, that the strategy needs to have these quantifiable, very specific targets, or there's no way of monitoring its success against it. Nobody, no matter who, can do it. I do think ESS might be potentially the route to be that independent assessment body, but I think it needs a bit more than that. We need the legislation itself to actually help to drive the process that Elisa was talking about. So, for example, we have a biodiversity duty in Scotland, and actually, arguably, it's stronger than the biodiversity duty in any other part of the UK, in that the duty on public bodies is to progress the conservation of biodiversity, not just have regard to. But there's also a clause in the end of it that says, in the ordinary conducting of its duties, which has always been used as a means to actually undermine the main thrust of that bit of legislation, which is to further the conservation of biodiversity. And it hasn't worked, obviously, because we're still losing biodiversity. We need these bits of legislation to be tightened up, okay, via the Natural Environment Bill, and we then need ESS to give them something to work with, which will be that legislation, and to hold public bodies to account in that sense. On funding, and it is a massive challenge. As I said earlier, the Green Finance Institute's estimate of how much would it cost to restore nature in Scotland, £15 to £20 billion. It's an enormous sum. I'm a part of a small group of environmental NGOs, including Woodland Trust Scotland, who have been trying to promote the conservation and restoration of Scotland's rainforest. And we took an estimate based on what's happened previously, work on the ground that's happened previously, and came up with an estimate of £500 million over a decade, at least a decade. So what I would say about these massive sums that I'm banding about, I'm not saying schools and hospitals aren't important, or there aren't any other financial imperatives. Of course, nobody is saying that. What we are saying is that they're very considerable sums, but actually the time period over which they can be spent is the entire time period of this strategy to 2045 and hopefully beyond. So I want to put that kind of marker down. There are also there's a brilliant precedent that we have in terms of the peatland action that the Scottish Government has pioneered. I mean, that is an example of ecosystem restoration in practice. £250 million of public money, across multiple years, but increasingly bringing in private finance in rather complex but very novel ways. And I can't sit here and actually prescribe how that could work across Scotland, but what I do think the strategy needs to do is to identify ecosystems like that. So we've got peatlands, but we also need Scotland's rainforest to be an identified ecosystem. We need the Macher to be, grasslands in the Western Isles, to be identified as a priority ecosystem. And as Elisa was saying, that Macher, the definition of Macher, which is the species, vastly species-rich grassland over in the Western Isles and the Hebrides, the definition is like that in the Habitats Directive. The big central paragraph is about agriculture. It's about crofting agriculture. And I think there's been a long history through the late 20th century and this century of really under-supporting our crofting communities, who are delivering biodiversity already and could do much more to prevent losses and indeed to restore ecosystems. So I think a programme of ecosystem restoration, which is what the EU is in the process of putting in place, needs to be in this. And it's simply not mentioned in the consultation. There is no programme of ecosystem restoration in this programme. And how it's financed, I can't be sure, but what we, the NGOs, are saying to government is around that £500 million, a huge ask for Scotland's rainforest, which, incidentally, the Minister has committed that Scotland's rainforest will be restored and expanded. That commitment was made at COP26, the climate COP. And what we're saying is £250 million of that from government over a decade or more, and the NGOs will work with external funders to raise the other £250 million. We can't make any promises, but we believe that is possible. Scotland's rainforest really has incredible resonance with the public. It has incredible resonance with funders. And we believe that some of the novel finance mechanisms which are beginning to come forward, that the peatland code is beginning to explore, if done in a way that's really guaranteed environmentally responsible, could be the potential to actually open up the finance that will be required to scale things up as we need to.
Very grateful. Bruce Wilson, would you like to talk about funding?
Yeah, I'll just try and add to what Paul said, which I agree with all of. That 50 to 20 billion is obviously a massive number, but there's two things I'd say about that. One is that sort of saving the natural environment isn't really optional if we want to have a functioning planet, so that's not something that we can really really decide not to do. It's absolutely essential. The economic strategies in Scotland have all identified that we're reliant on our natural world, and the last two of them have. So it's crucial for social, economic and environmental futures. Having said that, there is also massive opportunity. It doesn't just represent a spend that's written off. The return on investment on environmental green and blue infrastructure is known to be huge. NatureScot have put work into working out return on investment on specific schemes, but certain things that I've seen, 1 to 8 return on investment, up to 1 to 20. And an example of that might be investing in a woodland over a grey infrastructure culvert, something like that. So much cheaper to do, and that natural asset is providing benefit, not just for reducing the potential flood risk, it's providing biodiversity benefit, community benefit, an alternative income for the land manager, all sorts of different benefits that are not just a one-off spend on something like a culvert that would sit and only be used ideally once every 10 years for dealing with a one-off problem. So we can't see this as just only a challenge, and there are no opportunities. We need to think of those opportunities, and that does create opportunities for new business, new green collar economies with different jobs and things that can be associated with upskilling engineers, financiers, people within local authorities to think differently about how we interact with our natural environment. I think one of the other things that we need to do there as well is look at what was highlighted by Professor Sir Dasgupta into his Economics of Biodiversity review that was conducted recently. And he identified perverse subsidies as being something that we really need to tackle. So on one hand, we have a sticking plaster of biodiversity funding going against, subsidy, for example, on unsustainable agricultural practices. We need to get our policy aligned so that it's delivering for the climate and nature crisis, and not one policy going one way and one policy the other. And that will help reduce costs, because we won't be having as big an impact. There's also the kind of scale element. Paul talked about bringing in private sector investment. That absolutely needs to be done with a lot of scrutiny, and we're starting to see private sector investment. They tend to be called natural capital investments, but I mainly see that at the moment as more of a carbon offsetting investment. We need to get on top of that properly. The Scottish Government have got some good guidance out at the moment, but that area is going to grow and grow and grow. And in order for that to be a sort of just transition approach, we really need proper community involvement. Regional land use partnerships come from the Climate Act, and they're designed to help get community involvement in what land use change is going to look like. I don't think those are funded well enough to properly engage local communities. And we need that engagement, because the scale of investment that's needed for private sector is much bigger than the usual biodiversity projects we're used to working on in Scotland. 5 million is a big biodiversity project in Scotland generally. We're talking about investors needing to see projects of 1 billion plus. So we need to be able to scale up these projects. Nature networks are mentioned in this document. We think there is huge potential for that approach, to use an opportunity mapping based system to identify the best areas for investment, so we're going to improve ecosystem health and not just have a scattergun approach. Sorry, that was a long response.
A long but very, very useful response. And I think if NatureScot are watching this session and they have data on a return on investment, I'm sure the committee would be pleased to see it. Before I hand back to the convener, Susie, did you want to just add briefly to what Dr. Walton was saying?
Yeah, definitely, sir. I will make it very brief, and I just sort of have 3 points in particular to make. So the first thing would be completely supporting what Bruce said. Public funding can't do all of this. We do need private investment, but it does need to be really regulated and carefully regulated. And I think we also need to focus on the upcoming subsidies reviews that we're having. There's a lot of great opportunities for biodiversity within that. So in particular, agroforestry is a really good investment for biodiversity. So integrating trees onto farms, it's great for regulating soil temperatures, for sheltering livestock, for doing all of those things. But at this moment in time, the current schemes are either oversubscribed or they're too prescriptive. So we need to make changes to those to encourage people to do things like agroforestry and integrate trees onto their farms. And I suppose the last point that I wanted to raise is there is at times opportunities for better use of current funding. So I know I've mentioned deer before and how we really need to address deer and manage deer across Scotland, because it has an impact on native woodlands, but it also has an impact on peatland, on agricultural land. It's a huge, huge issue. So one of the things that we potentially could do would be to phase out funding for deer fencing and put that into deer management, because we put a lot of money into deer fencing. But if we better direct that funding, perhaps it would have a bigger impact for biodiversity. But that's it. Thank you.
Very grateful. Professor Morgera.
Thank you. Now, just briefly to support what's been said and just to reiterate the point that I think biodiversity finance should not be seen as an isolated pot of money that we need to find somewhere, but it's really about using the existing amount of funding, public funding that we have, including climate funding and other, to also address biodiversity, or to use as biodiversity as a way to achieve multiple public policy objectives. And I think the example of ecosystem restoration and how that supports public health, how it supports the realization of other social goals is really essential. And so the idea of, like, how can we join up thinking of public spending and thinking about public saving? What is that going to save us in the long run once we identify all these co-benefits arising from an investment in biodiversity? So it's not so much about finding new money, but it's about rethinking about how we use the existing pots we have. And so that's the real biodiversity mainstreaming that needs to happen. And I think the other two points I want to share, particularly in terms of the importance of legislating on budgeting, is that there's a lot that we can learn from human rights budgeting. And again, there's a big opportunity with the work on human rights leadership and the human rights bill to have that joined up thinking on the budget that's needed and all the benefits to public service, to human rights realization in the protection of biodiversity. I'm thinking particularly health equity issues in Scotland. And we have the case studies that were discussed about ecosystem restoration in Scotland have very clear quantifiable benefits in terms of health, but also, I think, support to persons with disabilities, etc. So we have cases and there's experience, I think, to address this from the human rights expertise in government. And the final point is that we should consider research funding not as something that happens before we make these interventions, but in fact another pot of money that can support and make these interventions itself. So that suggestion about partnership between researchers, crofters, NGOs, local communities, that can be funded through research funding itself. It's research that supports that learning and creates these new transformative ways to either support existing good practices, upscale them, or identify new ways to better care for our biodiversity.
Very grateful to all the panel. Back to you, Convener.
Okay, I'll come to Mark Ruskell first, followed by Monica Lennon, but conscious of time, if you can maybe direct your questions to specific individuals.
Thanks. I mean, we already had some comment about alignment and policy coherence. What more do you think the biodiversity strategy should be doing to direct that? Or is that perhaps not even for the strategy, it's for another approach within government? Can I start with Professor Morgera, please?
Yeah, no, I think this is actually the crux of the matter. I mean, biodiversity is one of the most fundamental keys for achieving policy coherence across so many areas of public policy. And so I think the strategy should be explicit about how and in all the ways in which biodiversity supports policy coherence. And that, I think that's, again, that kind of homework that It has to come from the biodiversity pieces of policies to show other sectors how investing and supporting biodiversity helps achieving those other co-benefits. So specific examples, I think maybe, I mean, to my mind, kind of ecosystem restoration and human health is a really crucial one, but there may be many others, and I think maybe more explicit examples on biodiversity and climate mitigation or climate adaptation would be essential to really make that message clear. But I think it should come from this strategy, and then you already kind of open up the way more for that mainstreaming to happen in other sectors.
Okay. Do others have brief comments that build on their previous comments? Susie?
Yeah, just a very brief one, and I suppose this is, I completely agree with everything you said, but maybe just more of a specific example. So of why we should have coherence between sort of biodiversity and maybe things like planning policy. So one of the biggest things that we deal with as the Woodland Trust is inappropriate development, and it impacts on ancient woodlands, on native woodlands, and these are some of our most biodiverse habitats. So we need to ensure that we have policy coherence. So for example, in the new draft national planning framework, we need to make sure that that has provisions in there that protect the biodiversity that we have. That's all I'll say.
Paul.
Yes, policy coherence, you could call that mainstreaming as well, is absolutely critical. It hasn't been achieved, but again, I want to focus on examples where it has been achieved in Scotland. I think in terms of climate policy, we're really getting places in terms of it actually climate policy influencing other policy areas and other sectors. And really, I can't sort of say a single stroke of a pen, that's how you achieve this policy coherence. But one thing we could do is call this strategy Scotland's Nature Emergency Strategy. I mean, biodiversity is too easily siloed, too easily a specialist interest, a bunch of anoraks with beards, you know, catching butterflies, that's biodiversity over there, let's get on with the real business. The world is in a nature crisis. Scotland is absolutely part of it. The Biodiversity Intactness Index shows that this country is 28th from the bottom of world countries and territories in terms of our biodiversity intactness. We're relatively good in terms of the UK, and it just makes you wonder what potential is for restoration, because we still have incredible biodiversity in this country despite what I've just said. Mm-hmm. So what we need is for people to understand there's a nature emergency that affects everybody, that has links through to health, that has links through to finance. And in terms of this, avoiding spend further on, if you invest in invasive non-native species biosecurity, it is hundreds of times cheaper than dealing with the issues when you have to do large-scale eradications and take all the action we have to do for rhododendron, for example. You can save that money by having appropriate legislation, appropriate public policy, and appropriate funding for biosecurity measures, like what we have at the moment for the Saving Scotland's Red Squirrel work, which is stopping grey squirrels invading the Highlands. That's not just about red squirrels. This is a species initiative which actually potentially has huge implications for the finance of woodland expansion across the Highlands, okay, because grey squirrels will affect woodland expansion. So, yeah, a bit of a long answer, but why don't we actually just call it Scotland's Nature Emergency Strategy? We've suggested it, and that suggestion has not been accepted.
Yeah. But is there something more fundamental here, though, in the way that government and agencies actually work within that permanent architecture of civil servants and agencies like NatureScot? Is there something a bit more fundamental here about its, you know, is it prepared enough to tackle something like a nature emergency? Because this is still a biodiversity strategy. It's not a central, it doesn't encompass the entire of government.
What I'm referring to, if I may, is for example, you know, so not saying that a bit of the agriculture budget might be geared towards specific biodiversity work, but the rest of it is really about supporting farmers to be farmers. What it's about is working with the agricultural communities across Scotland and saying that maybe three quarters of that budget really needs to be targeted at climate and nature restoration to achieve the kind of things that we want, and how can that work in agricultural reality? And the RSPB has a long history, for example, Corncrake work that we've done in actually making biodiversity prescriptions work for farms and crofters within the restrictions that they have, financial and practical and in terms average of their working year. And so these things can be done. We have examples. It is about having the will to expand them, I think. And the basic structure of having a public agency with responsibility for nature conservation, I think, is probably, in net terms, a very good thing. But we do need to see more ambition, and we need to see recognition that there is a nature emergency.
Okay. I'll come to Bruce, but if I could roll in my final question. We've spoken a lot about the strategy and the high-level objectives. There are, of course, delivery plans that will come on the back of that, and I understand the first one will be coming in December. Can you just give us, your understanding of what delivery plans should be covering? What are the essentials that should be coming out of that? Bruce, do you want to go first and wrap up my previous question?
Yeah, sure. So I think just your previous question, just to reiterate the vital importance of targets and actually starting work on getting those targets right now and getting the relevant, knowledgeable stakeholders around the table to try and work out how that's going to work in a Scottish context will be important. I'll cover the delivery strategies in a second, but the knowledge and evidence part that I spoke to last time, biodiversity is not well understood out with Nature Scot and other parts of Scottish Government at all. We often see things just described as green, and that's everything from renewable technologies to insulating homes all the way through to species programmes. We need to get better about understanding the wildlife and nature elements of that, and that is going to require upskilling across industry and through government as well, and that's a big need. There's opportunity there around job creation, but there's certainly a need for us to work on that. In terms of delivery strategies themselves, they need to be smart, and we've covered that, so I'll keep that quite a brief point, but they really need to be smart, and they need to really address that quote that I gave at the beginning as well around how that is going to be properly mainstreamed, particularly through the relevant parts of government that are having the biggest influence over those different policy areas.
Okay. Alisa?
Yeah, thanks. I think this may speak also to the question you posed just before around, what's the fundamental question for government? And I think it's that having that understanding of what biodiversity is and what it does for us, and that's our basic infrastructure for everything that we want to deliver across government. So there is a fundamental element maybe of knowledge that we need to share across it. And if some of that could come from the strategy, I think that might be as important as very, specific targets. So I'm thinking there's nothing mentioned on genetic diversity in the strategy, and that is what makes our food security, for instance, something very real. There's nothing about the importance of bioinnovation and how we learn from nature and become, really advanced economies based on innovation. There's nothing there about microbes and how our very health, our psychological development, our mental, our capacity to bounce back from surgical operations depends on having access not to just green spaces, but to biodiverse spaces where our microbiome is in contact with microbes out there. So maybe there is an element there, I think, of teasing out some key aspects of how biodiversity is fundamental and we often don't know about, and then how that should speak to several parts of government that we might not think have anything to do with biodiversity, but in fact the very existence of their policy objectives depends on that viability of diversity of life here in Scotland.
Yeah. Yeah, Susie.
Just a very quick point to finish off. I think we understand, as you've said, that the Scottish Government is proposing these five-year delivery plans, but I think it's important to note that robust delivery plans are not a substitute for clearer outcomes and high-level targets in the strategy itself. So in terms of what we're proposing, we are proposing targets which match the key 2030 and 2045 milestones. So I think there's also a really useful way of monitoring progress of our halting and reversing biodiversity loss.
Thanks. Paul, briefly.
Yeah, as Susie said, these delivery plans, what are they delivering? They're delivering the strategy. At the moment, the strategy does not specify a programme of species recovery. It does not specify a programme of ecosystem restoration. Biodiversity comprises species and ecosystems without some explicit mention of those programmes, to expect this to work across future administrations up to 2045, I think is whistling in the wind, frankly. The strategy must specify what the delivery plans are expected to deliver against, and it must have some broad but specific targets so that the progress can be monitored. Without those in the strategy itself, the thing is, in my view, almost destined to fail, unfortunately.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Monica Lennon, and then finally Jackie DeBar.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to our panel. Thank you for your very clear evidence and your written submissions as well. On a positive note, I think RSPB Scotland, in your written submission, you say that the strategy or the document does a really good job of defining the problem. So I think that's a good place to start. So no one's in denial, and the Scottish Government's been very clear about the challenges. So it seems to me we have a very high-level vision document that is aspirational, and that's really good. But we're hearing today a lot of concerns about lack of clarity around targets and outcomes and delivery. Can I just return back to Dr. Paul Walton, because you made the point a moment ago about reframing this as Scotland's nature emergency strategy rather than a biodiversity strategy. And I was going to ask about that, so I'm glad that you did bring it up. I just want to quickly go round the other witnesses to find out if they agree with that, because is it just about a name, or does that have much more meaning, bearing in mind some of the risks that we've just heard if we don't change the approach? So maybe start with Bruce and go along the table. Should we rename it?
Definitely 100% agree with what Paul said there. This really needs a paradigm shift in the way that we view this as a fringe issue into completely mainstreaming it. I think we also need more context in the strategy about where this sits amongst other bits of government policy as well, and how important it is. So, yep, I very much agree with that suggestion.
I'm going to come to Susie, but I wonder if you could add to it by saying, do you think that could help reduce the risk of a siloed approach if we think about it as nature emergency?
It could slightly reduce the risk of the siloed approach. I can't remember the exact wording of the first question in this consultation, but it was along the lines of, do you agree that there is a nature emergency? And I think that was designed to try and surface any people that might disagree with that, but we wouldn't see that in the context of the economic crisis, of the climate crisis, of lots of other things that we're dealing with. The Scottish Government, the United Nations, and everyone in between agrees that there is a nature crisis. So to sort of start this off by, you know, do we actually think there's a problem here? It's really disheartening for our organisations here, and we really need to get that up the agenda. That sort of paradigm shift thing's maybe a bit overused, but it does need that. And the title maybe can't do that much to affect it, but it's a start. It also needs all the other mainstreaming things that we've outlined as well.
Thank you, Bruce. Susie?
Yeah, completely agree. I think naming it as the nature emergency strategy would be great. I think at the beginning of the Scottish biodiversity strategy, they give definitions of biodiversity and definitions of nature. And I think calling it the nature emergency probably shows how interconnected biodiversity is with all the components of our natural environment. And that maybe gives a sort of gravity to the impact that this crisis will have on us. So, yeah, I would completely agree with that, definitely.
Professor Margera.
Yeah, no, I also think it's a good suggestion, and it would also help to bring biodiversity in line with climate change here in Scotland, where we have already declared a climate emergency. Maybe in addition to that, not leaving it just as biodiversity emergency again of its own, but really thinking about the repercussion that this has for sustainable development. So the IPBS indicated that 80% of the SDG targets can't be realized because of biodiversity loss. And equally, it's a human rights emergency as well. So I think calling it biodiversity emergency or nature emergency is a good idea, as long as we also show that it is part of that understanding of the interconnections with climate change and the implications that go well beyond what people may immediately think as biodiversity. And if I may just say briefly something, you mentioned the point about how the evidence is used in the strategy. I mean, the initial section is helpful to show how much evidence has been gathered, but then the evidence is not used in the rest of the document. And this is where there's a big gap between what we know and how we then can shape those targets and make those connections on the basis that of the evidence we have. And I think that's one of the biggest opportunity here, to be, you know, to have a really informed strategy. But giving that sense of urgency and how crucial this is really important as a highlight.
That's really helpful. Thank you. I've got one final question, but briefly, Dr. Walton.
Yeah, I was just going to say that the evidence chapter, okay, is progress, because for decades, frankly, there has been a sort of dominant narrative from successive administrations in Scotland that nature's great in Scotland. Look out your window, look at the lovely hills and the heather moorland, and it's great, nature's fantastic, there isn't really a problem. So we have seen that shift, and that's a very, very welcome shift. And indeed, we now share things like the State of Nature Report, which is an NGO-led effort to get the best understanding of where we are with nature. That is now becoming increasingly a shared evidence base across government. So we're beginning to see some progress there. The really, frankly, strange thing about this consultation document is that, as Alyssa said, the rest of it simply does not reflect the seriousness of the issue that's laid out in the first chapter and does not point towards any sort of meaningful solutions. And that is going to be a big problem. And it's a really big problem, particularly in terms of government agencies and NGOs need to show a shared collective endeavour when we approach external funders. The NLHF, for example, have told us, you guys really need to get together and decide what your shared priorities are. I don't see this strategy as deciding it, so it might actually have implications well beyond just arguments between government and NGOs. It might be implications in terms of how much money comes into biodiversity conservation in the future from external sources.
Again, that's really helpful. I have a final question. I'll come back to you, Paul, on this one, and maybe others can indicate if they want to contribute to the answer. I wanted to raise the recent outbreak of avian flu while we have you here, and the impact on Scotland's wild bird population. I'm just wondering if you believe it has any implications for Scotland's biodiversity strategy. Is there anything that you'd want to bring to our attention?
Absolutely. Avian influenza is a massive wake-up call. It is completely unprecedented in global terms, the impacts we have seen over the past 18 months. It's never happened before. It was entirely unexpected it would find its way into seabirds. The Great Skua, or Bonxie as they call it in Shetland. Scotland has 60% of the world population breeds here. Our main colonies are down, we think, we can't tell yet exactly, by 70 to 80%. There is potential that species will go globally extinct on our watch. We have most of them in our country. Now, in discussions with the Minister, I've heard on several occasions, we're interested in ecosystems, we're not really interested in single species conservation. Scotland's seabirds are internationally important. Before avian influenza hit, they declined by 49% since 1986. So they're already halved because of pressures like competition with fisheries for sand eels, climate change, invasive species on islands, and being tangled up in fishing gear. These are major pressures on internationally important species for which we have a global responsibility. This is why we're calling for a programme of species recovery in the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy. And avian influenza's impact, its massive impact that it seems to have had on our species, some of which are internationally important, needs to be a wake-up call. It needs to be, we need a step change in ambition, and we need to build resilience in our populations to coming pressures. And bird flu is an anthropogenic pressure. Not in this country, but it originated in poultry in Eastern Asia and spread across Eurasia largely because of the movement of poultry and poultry products, and then passed secondarily into wild birds and is now moving around and spreading in wild birds. So it's a huge wake-up call for us. And we can expect, unfortunately, new, novel anthropogenic pressures to impact on the natural world. And that's why this biodiversity strategy is critical and why it has to be ambitious to make sure that we maximise resilience to that change. And in the vision section, for example, in initial draft, it talked about reversing biodiversity loss and halting extinctions. Those were removed from the current draft, so they're no longer in the vision. So it is quite strange for us who've been involved in the process how we've ended up with something that really lacks the sufficient ambition to really be meaningful.
Thank you. I know we're quickly running out of time, so I'll hand back to convener, but thank you very much.
And thank you very much for bringing that so forcefully to our attention. Jackie Dunbar.
Good morning, panel. I really am conscious of time, so I'll just get straight to it, if you don't mind. The UK Levelling Up and Regeneration Bill includes powers to amend environmental assessments with potential to affect assessments under the Habitats regulations. What implications does this have for Scotland's biodiversity policy? And Dr Paul, you've caught my eye. Sorry, Dr Paul okay. Wilson, you've caught my eye, so I'll go to you first. And if anyone would like to come in.
Okay, I'm not a specialist in this area, but essentially what they're trying to do is to reform planning legislation in England, okay, and as part of that, there's this kind of curveball seems to have come where the UK Secretary of State, I believe the DEFRA Secretary of State, would be given the power to override in secondary legislation at UK level, primary legislation that's been put in place by this Parliament, in terms of environmental impact assessments, strategic environmental assessments and habitat regulation assessments under the habitats regulations. We think that this is quite a risky move, quite aside from any issues of democratic legitimacy. It sort of brings the basic environmental protection legislation straight into a constitutional debate, which might not be entirely helpful. But it also... if you like, so creates a sort of a difficulty in terms of the Scottish Government's commitments to maintain those EU standards, to keep track of EU standards or exceed them. I mean, it may be if the UK isn't actually adopting similar environmental protection standards that the will of the Scottish Parliament is undermined in that sort of way as well, and we are beginning to see environmental impacts. What we would say to the Scottish Government is, if this does go forward, we'd ask the Scottish Government to make sure that planning matters in Scotland and planning decisions the standards are maintained as a matter of policy. So quite often planning decisions are made as a matter of policy rather than a matter of legislation. So we would urge that to happen. But I think it's fair to say that Scottish Environment Lick is quite concerned about this, and we have indeed written to the UK Secretary of State and copied in the relevant ministers in Scotland as well.
Okay, thank you. Is anybody else would like to add anything? Or?
No, nope. I think we have a briefing on the subject that we can circulate to the committee again if that's helpful.
Okay, that would be grand. Do I have time for my second question, convener? Okay. In regards, the Natural Environment Bill is due to be introduced in the third year of this Parliament. So can I ask what legislative changes, if any, do you think are required to deliver changes needed for our terrestrial environment? Can I go to Susie Saunders first, please? Oh,
sorry, just get my notes together. We do also need an environment bill, as you've said, to put in statutory nature targets. And legislative requirements are really great because they focus action, like the statutory climate change emissions reductions targets, and it helps direct things like fundings. But I think, the most important thing that I would want to get across through this, although the legislation is really important, and I know we've mentioned this so many times today, but having smart targets actually within this strategy, and that would be my message that I would drive home. So in particular for native woodlands, we need to make sure that we have targets for their expansion, for protecting them, for restoring them, and we need to make sure that we're having targets that help drive or help tackle the drivers of biodiversity loss. So yeah, my key message, smart targets in the strategy.
Okay. Would anybody else like to add anything?
Yeah,
Bruce Wilson, please.
I agree with that entirely, and maybe just to sort of slightly answer the last question as well, that we've got the Scottish EU Continuity Bill, and elements of that are referenced within the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy that we're discussing as well. To sort of properly realise that ambition, we do need to get these targets quickly, and that alignment, there's the EU Nature Restoration Law that's already mentioned as well. It'll be very important that we strive to match or exceed that. So that's important that we also look at the issues raised by your previous question as well in relation to that.
Okay, thank you. And Professor Morgera.
Thank you. Well, I think that there's three things that have emerged from the discussion today that will be important to reflect in legislation. The first is making sure there's full coverage of all the elements of international obligations on biodiversity, so conservation of ecosystems, species, and action on the genetic level, and then including conservation, restoration, and also action on invasive alien species. So it has to be comprehensive in scope and making sure there's no gaps in the current legal system. The second is really building the conditions for applying an ecosystem approach. And so that means that policy coherence, joined up work across government, but also a participatory process, so that kind of bottom-up discussion and integration of local knowledge. And that needs to be legislated, because in fact we're looking at procedures for participation and, you know, relying on human rights standards for that, because the protection of biodiversity is what everyone's basic human rights rely on.
Thank you. Dr. Walton.
Yeah, absolutely. Targets is the key message that you're getting from us. But I want this committee to be fully conscious that it's actually going to be quite a risky thing, because if we end up with targets that are very weak and perhaps too specific, say, we'll kind of focus on 10 species a year or something like that, when we have tens of thousands of species out there, a high proportion of which are in conservation need. Exactly what these targets are, these legally binding targets in law, is going to be critical in terms of how successful we are in delivering against biodiversity. It's going to be politically really challenging, because the gravity is always going to be towards let's make them as vague and let's make them as light touch as possible. And I suspect we may have seen something like that happening at the UK level. If Scotland wants to lead, we're going to have to somehow in this Parliament develop a shared ambition to have really meaningful, really ambitious and very specific targets that are going to be challenging. And that politically, I think, is a tough one, but that is what is required. If we end up with weak targets, it could be worse than if there weren't targets at all. So we have failed repeatedly, globally and nationally, to meet our biodiversity requirements because we haven't had legally binding targets. It seems to be the only way forward, but it is a politically challenging thing to make it work.
Okay, thank you. I'm afraid I'm going to have to bring this to a close. That has been an extremely helpful session. Thank you for your clarity and for your challenge. And I will now briefly suspend this meeting for the setup of our next panel, and I intend to move right into that. Thank you.
We now resume with our second panel in relation to Scottish biodiversity strategy, and we'll now focus on the marine environment. So I welcome our panellists. They are Callum Duncan, Head of Conservation, Scotland Marine Conservation Society, and Craig McAdam, Convener, Scottish Environment Link Freshwater Group. And I also welcome Susan Davis, Chief Executive, Scottish Seabird Centre, who is joining us remotely. Very welcome. I hope, Susan, you can hear us loud and clear. Thank you. Thanks for joining us today. I will go through the panel members with their questions, but I just want to kick off with that question about why Scotland has struggled to make progress in slowing and reversing biodiversity declines. In your view, what are the key challenges for Scotland, and what are the reason that some targets have been missed to date? And I could maybe come to can I come to Craig McAdam first, and then move to Callum Duncan after that, and then to Susan Davis. So, Craig, please.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for inviting us to give evidence to the committee. The previous strategies have, I suppose, lacked ambition. We've seen progressive sort of like programmes of restoration that just haven't come to fruition. We've seen a lack of joined up thinking across government and across social society. You know, the previous strategy was all about mainstreaming, and we've just not seen that. If we want to if we want to see biodiversity restored, we really need to mainstream. We need to look at everybody doing their bit to actually help biodiversity. I noticed you mentioned it was a marine section, and I'm actually a freshwater specialist and from the freshwater group. So my take is from the yeah. watery bits yeah. on land. And you know, this current draft of the biodiversity strategy doesn't actually mention a lot about fresh water. It doesn't mention that we've got a river basin management plan in Scotland, you know, which is a key way of delivering action for fresh waters. That said, the river basin management plan isn't particularly ambitious either. And you know, for one particular you know aspect, you could look at the impoundments on rivers and barriers on rivers that stop natural flow processes, and at the rate that that is in the River Basin Management Plan, it's going to take us maybe 100 years to actually rid our rivers of derelict and disused barriers. So yeah, we need a lot more ambition, we need a lot more leadership and direction to our restoration, and we need more action.
Thank you, and sorry for mistitling you, but we really want to hear from your advice, obviously in the freshwater side in particular. Can I move to Callum, please?
Thank you for convener and for inviting me here. I mean, having been involved with the drafting of previous strategies, I have a recollection of a lot of onus being put on legislation that was needed, and we were glad that we helped secure that in terms of the Marine Scotland Act, for example. So the experience of the biodiversity strategies before was very much about documents that were, you know, were driving some welcome awareness raising and local activity, but they weren't really driving systemic change or looking at the sort of transformative change that was needed. And they were, I think they were right pre-2010 to recognise that we needed new legislation to drive the enhancement of the sea, set up a planning system, set up a network of MPAs. So we were obviously very pleased when that was secured. So in terms of you know, why we are where we are now, the rollout of that hasn't been quick enough or robust enough. At the same time, there hasn't been that mainstreaming in other parts of civic society. So there's maybe been a bit of a sort of silo mentality there. And as the international reports that have been cited earlier have said, from the UN and so on, we need transformative change across all sectors. We all rely on biodiversity for our very survival. So every single part of society has to be thinking about, and every single sectoral and economic activity has to be thinking about what it does for nature. Unfortunately, because there hasn't been that, I should be clear, very much welcome the progress that has been made, although it's been slow, and there has been some good progress in
isolated areas, in submarine protected areas, and getting the management measures in place for some of the most vulnerable sites in shore in 2016, for example. But it's not been fast enough or ambitious enough, and then we haven't looked at what the other pillars of the marine nature conservation strategy are doing. So we have to be looking at wider seas measures like fisheries management, like marine planning as well, to deliver for nature. And there's been delays in all of those things. And that pace, and that lack of achievement was clear with good environmental status. So our NGOs and others concluded that the aim to have our seas in good environmental status by 2020 was a spectacular failure, and that's what we said 2 years ago. And that required biodiversity to be maintained, never mind recovered. So we failed to maintain it. It required populations of commercial fish species to be healthy. It required elements of food webs to ensure long-term abundance and reproduction, and it required that seafloor integrity, that is the health and the status of the seabed, so that the seabed can keep doing what it does, ensures functioning of the ecosystem. So really fundamental aspects of what we were supposed to have achieved have failed. So it's absolutely, I would echo everything that I heard in the earlier session. All that applies at sea, and in terms of the biodiversity strategy, it's a tale of two halves. The first half, it's a great setup of the evidence of decline and concern, but the second half, you come to the marine section, and it's very vague. It's not smart enough. It's not targeted enough. It's not acknowledging the sectoral actions across fisheries, aquaculture, offshore energy that need to be done. We've got 8 years to turn this around, so it needs to be visionary, it needs to be smart.
Susan Davis, can I come to you, please?
Thank you very much, and apologies for not being able to be with you in person today. I think one of the key things that we need to address as we move forward with this biodiversity strategy is about the leadership and the primacy of the strategy. It absolutely has been shown in terms of climate change and the prominence of that, that when it is recognised as being a fundamental issue and a crisis, that progress is made. And similarly, the nature strategy, the biodiversity strategy, needs to be given some primacy and needs to be the lead strategy that other sectoral policies are required to demonstrate how they will contribute to it.
Thank you. I think we're fine with you on sound. Our visual is not as secure. We can see you, but broadcasting can indicate if you want to do anything on that. But we definitely heard what you said there, Susan. And I also just want to put the same question I asked the last panel, looking at the international picture with COP15 coming forward in terms of the expectations that you have of that, and what do you see as the interaction between the current consultation and Scotland strategy and COP15? I'll maybe come to Callum and then Craig and then to Susan, and broadcast can help us with any issues around Susan.
Thank you. I think we'd very much welcome the sort of ambition that's been shown by the European Union ahead of COP15, as Dr. Walton said this morning, talking about the importance of the nature restoration law. And my understanding is the European Union showed leadership, got ahead of global thinking by actually looking to enshrine in law nature restoration targets. It's maybe not helpful to get into big discussions about percentages, but having some welcome things in that law include at least 20% of all habitats under active restoration, and that's one example of the sort of targets and the sort of ambition that we'd like to see coming through in the biodiversity strategy, actively looking at every component of the ecosystem. So not just looking at, because the strategy is marine and coastal, but how does that break down? So we go from coastal through through the marine system. We're talking about sand dunes, we're talking about salt marshes, we're talking about reed beds, and we go into the intertidal seagrass beds and blue mussel beds. We go deeper into to muds, living reefs, flame shell beds, horse mussel beds, through cold water corals, deep water sponge communities. So from the marine perspective, we need a lot more, we'd like to see a lot more recognition at a sort of habitat by habitat basis, and have ambition for those habitats to be restored and recovered in order to meet some of the things I mentioned under the good environmental status requirements, but under building on those and looking at how to take those forward and enshrine them in law. So that ecosystem scale approach that breaks it down into the different component habitats and actually really thinks about, well, what proportion of these habitats do we need to recover, how do we recover them, and how do we go about recovering them? And it's not just about MPAs, it's about, we need to get them right, we need to properly protect them, but we need the wider seas work as well. What can fishing do outside MPAs as well to further biodiversity? How can we have a planning system that drives ecosystem restoration? How can our aquaculture industry reverse the impacts that it has on wild biodiversity, etc.?
And could I come to Craig McAdam on COP15 and how that can impact on how Scotland delivers on international obligations?
Sure, yeah. Like Callum, I'd like to see, strong leadership from leaders at COP and good targets coming out of that that can be then taken down into regions and then into countries. I mean, as Callum said, the EU biodiversity strategy, and now that the net restoration law, has some good targets in there, ambitious targets in there. In the freshwater sort of section, they've got 25,000 kilometres of free-flowing rivers will be restored across Europe, which is a fantastic ambitious target. It would be good to see that then get transferred down into countries, so that Scotland takes on a target like that. So what we see decided at COP comes through and is delivered by us here.
Okay, and I'm going to come to Susan. Susan, I think we're going to put you on audio only so we can hear you loud and clear. So, Susan, what's your view, particularly around COP15 and the interaction with our own consultation and subsequent strategy?
Yes, I think COP15, again, it's got to be recognised that there is a need for pace, that this is an emergency that we're dealing with. And I think if Scotland really wishes to show leadership and to help drive some of that conversation and the targets which might come from COP15, then we need to take the steps to articulate very clearly at a Scottish level what our restoration and recovery goals are going to be for both ecosystems and for species. I think it's also very important to kind of recognise the importance of the public engagement and the education process as part of this exercise as well. And the current strategy that we have before us, the draft strategy, is particularly weak in terms of what that expectation would be, what the outcomes would be, and the targets for public engagement and education. But we do need that whole society buy-in for the change that is going to be required.
Thank you, Susan. I now move to Natalie Dawn to be followed by Liam Kerr.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. It's nice to see you. I will stick with the same theme as I did for the last panel and ask how you feel Scotland's efforts to tackle the biodiversity crisis in marine and freshwater environments compare with other countries. And are there any instances of best practice, anything that we could learn from? I'll go to Craig first, please.
Yeah, thanks for the question. In freshwater, we've had some good successes. We've done some good work on freshwater pearl mussels through the Pearls and Peril project. We've started to introduce schemes like river woods and riparian woodland creation, which is going to help to tackle both the biodiversity crisis and the climate crisis, keeping rivers cool. So there's good stuff happening. It's happening in a very piecemeal sort of a approach. It's very much funding dependent. It's not really mainstreamed. So the Pearls and Peril project finished, 4 or 5 years ago, and there's not really been a concerted programme to keep going. These are animals that live for over 100 years, so a five-year project isn't really going to be enough to see them through their life cycle. So we need to have more secure funding, I guess, and or targeted funding, more targeted funding. We can see what's happened with Peatland Action, where we've got a programme of peatland restoration across Scotland. The Nature Restoration Fund is now doing bits across Scotland. What we really need is for each ecosystem having a dedicated fund that can actually do that. Looking across the border, there's an announcement yesterday, I think it was, of big landscape scale programmes of work for biodiversity and for nature and for climate. And that's the sort of ambition that we need to have. We're looking across a whole landscape, not just this river here or that hill there. Let's try and get it across Scotland.
Thank you. You mentioned some instances of things that are happening in Scotland that are positive and that we could maybe expand on or sort of roll out nationally. I'll come to Callum next. If you could maybe expand on that in terms of things that other countries are doing, but also anything positive that's happening within Scotland that could be expanded on.
Yeah, certainly. Thank you. The Marine Scotland Act I mentioned is world-leading legislation in terms of requiring the planning system, the MPA network, and the enhancement duty in there, the sustainable development enhancement duty and duty to mitigate the impacts of climate change. So it's very visionary legislation, world-class. But then there's the delivery side of it. The MPA process in Scotland was very good, scientifically founded, stood up to scrutiny and independent challenge, engaged all the stakeholders, and delivered the bulk of a network of sites, which has since been very much welcomely added to through other sites that have come along since, such as the West of Scotland MPA, the emergency MPA for Loch Carron, the new emergency MPA for Red Rock and Longay for skate eggs. So, but without management in place, they're paper parks. So there was good management that came in 2016 to protect the most vulnerable inshore sites from the most damaging forms of fishing for those features in the sites, the habitats that are particularly vulnerable to bottom toed fishing gear. That was a welcome suite of fisheries management measures protecting over 2,000 kilometres squared of inshore sites, protecting vital ecosystem engineers like mirrel beds, flame shell beds, and other habitats. The enforcement of those is another matter. So there's still concerns about how these measures are actually enforced, and there's several instances of concern about conservation orders being breached. So. Again, it's a bit of a mixed picture, and that's why we're calling for remote electronic monitoring on all vessels, and we welcome that commitment for the scallop fleet to start with. Again, it's not happening quick enough. It's a mixed bag, better on paper, and it's important about getting on with the delivery, and that includes the new and very welcome commitments in the Bute House Agreement as well on highly protected marine areas and so on. So I'm jumping to the future there, but in terms of other good examples in Scotland, I would never tire of citing the inspiring work of the Community of Arran Seabed Trust that pioneered this very small no-take zone in North Lamlash Bay, which has then become the core of a wider MPA in South Arran, and that is a real beacon of hope and recovery, where you're seeing richer seabed habitats, you're seeing more and larger scallops and lobsters and so on. So there's signs of what is possible if we can get it right. In terms of going internationally, on the policy side, Canada has always led the way in terms of having holistic ocean policies and having marine ecosystem objectives. So they've been talking about that for decades, looking at what it is, what it is that they want their seas to look like, and setting up networks and having a commission to actually look at whether their network is working. So Canada is somewhere I would look to. New Zealand, there are some good examples there of actual pioneering of simple protection measures. The world's first no-take zone was Cape Rodney to Okakari Point Marine Reserve, University of Auckland, on the North Island, and that showed what can be done if you just leave a bit of seabed alone. Mm. And you had these spiny lobsters spilling out from this reserve, and local fishermen went from opponents and critics to supporters of it. And then my last example I'd probably give is the United States of America, who are actually globally very progressive on fisheries management, including spatial management of fishing. I believe the management of the scallop fishery on the East Coast is one that's very worth looking at in terms of actually spatially managing fishing, which is something that I think is really important, and really important in Scotland. And New Zealand and USA are also countries that are pioneering the remote electronic monitoring with cameras as well. Biodiversity recovery, ocean recovery, isn't just about fisheries management, but it's such a widespread pressure, as Scotland's Marine Assessment recognises, that that, you know, good examples of fisheries management are also good for biodiversity.
Thanks very much, Callum. Yeah, we discussed New Zealand quite at length in the last panel, so there's definitely things to learn there, but it's very useful to have those other examples as well. I'll just turn lastly to Susan. So it's just if you've anything to add in terms of the question proposed, which is how Scotland's efforts tackle the biodiversity crisis in marine and freshwater environments and how that compares with other countries. I'll bring Susan in. Thank you.
Yes, I think, I mean, I would echo much of what Callum has outlined there in terms of we do have some world-leading legislation and policies, and it's the translation of those into implementation and the resources to do that that probably lets us down. And that's really where we need to kind of sort of focus the effort and why it's important with this new biodiversity strategy that we're clear on what the sort of delivery mechanisms and the resources required are going to be. I think just, again, you know, it's been highlighted the New Zealand biodiversity strategy, the whole biosecurity approach in terms of New Zealand is an exceptional example to look at. But there are other examples which we can, you know, get access to through IUCN, things like the Kiwi Initiative, which really help build capacity at the community level to respond to climate resilience and nature loss through taking forward nature-based solutions. But I don't think in international terms and global terms that there is any one country that has got the totally right solution, but we can find examples to address particular issues in a range of different countries and try to draw on those to make sure that the approach that we are taking both, you know, brings people together, is community-led as well in terms of that restoration, but also helps build capacity for the future.
Thanks, Susan. Thank you all for your answers.
I'm going to come to Liam Kerr and then to Mark Ruskell, please.
Very grateful. Good morning, panel. Craig McAdam, a question for you first, please. One of the conditions for success is this independent monitoring and reporting body alongside an improved framework. You heard me ask about it earlier, I'm sure, but the consultation doesn't say what either of these should really look like. Do you take a view?
I think the consultation also doesn't say what success should look like either. I think that's where we really lack targets in this consultation. We don't know where we're actually aiming for, how ambitious it is going to be. So I think, you know, it's almost like a chicken and egg thing there, that we need to know what the targets are to know what the body that's going to be policing them will look like.
That's very helpful, thank you. Susan Davis, I'll move on to a slightly different topic. I asked earlier about funding. Obviously, if you want to pick up on the conditions for success around monitoring, then by all means do so. But you heard me ask earlier about funding and sources, and we got some pretty big numbers from the earlier panel. Do you have any views when it comes to funding on whether the consultation deals with this question realistically, and in any event, where we get that level of funding from, what the sources are, please?
Yes, I think, I mean, we really do have funding challenges, and I think they're in a number of different ways. We've largely been reliant on public funds and or charitable fundraising to take forward some of the response to biodiversity and the loss of biodiversity. But quite often those funding mechanisms are annual, when in actual fact we need commitments over the long term, and we need to know what resources are available over the long term for different ecosystems. And quite often those funding streams are capital, as in infrastructure capital, rather than natural capital building. And so we either need to look at the definition of what can be funded, and we also need to look at having revenue funding, because whilst there are some capital works which are required for nature restoration and recovery, a lot of it is about ongoing management and revenue funding. And I think, as in the earlier session, you know, figures of 15 to 20 billion have been highlighted by the Green Finance Institute as the requirement. And it's quite clear that we need to think very carefully about, you know, how things like the Scotland Legacy Fund, the infrastructure levy, and whether opportunities exist around nature climate bonds in order to bring in private finance as well. And we've got, you know, we've got examples that are starting to develop. You know, the Scottish Marine Environmental Enhancement Fund is a welcome step for the marine environment, but again, it suffers from some of that annuality and some of the issues around capital spend and when it has, you know, when spend has to take place. So we really do need to look at the mechanisms and the longevity of those funding instruments going forward. Just in terms of the, sorry, just in terms of the conditions of success, I would just, you know, echo the point that we absolutely need clear targets. But I do think Environmental Standards Scotland has, you know, the remit to actually, you know, be looking at monitoring the progress, and it has some of the statutory powers in order to take forward some of the regulation and the enforcement in terms of, you know, compliance notes, improvement notes, and also judicial review. So I think Environmental Standards Scotland as a monitoring body should certainly be one body that should be looked at with adequate resources to monitor progress. But first off, we need very clear targets that we're going to be aiming for.
It's very interesting. Thank you very much for that answer. Callum Duncan, I'll move to you finally. On a slightly different matter, again, if you have anything to contribute to that, then by all means do so. The National Marine Plan was reviewed excuse me, in spring 2021, as it's required to be, and ministers are now required to decide whether to amend or replace the current plan, which I understand has not been updated or amended since 2015. Do you take a view on what should be done, particularly in relation to your submission that there needs to be alignment between the biodiversity strategy and other policies such as this?
Thank you. We think the National Marine Plan should be amended. Mm-hmm. We welcomed the first plan with concerns at the time that it wasn't properly addressing or recognising what became the climate emergency in the oil and gas chapter. So there was a climate change objective for that sector in the plan that was talking about the emissions of extracting oil and gas and wasn't actually looking at the impacts of the burning of the oil and gas that's extracted. So that was a big contradiction in that part of the National Marine Plan. And the other area that we raised concerns about, I'll come on to a positive in a minute, but the other one we raised concerns about was in relation to the aquaculture sector. We were concerned that it had just lifted what we viewed as an unsustainable aquaculture growth target and put it into planning policy, which we didn't think was good policy. I mean, to be clear, like with any sector, we support sustainable activities. It's not about saying, you know, we need the just transition for oil and gas, but we also need you know, transitions for the aquaculture sector to one that's more sustainable. And and likewise the fishing sector. So we think the National Marine Plan should be amended and should be looking at how the different sectors deliver for climate targets that are required, but also for nature as well, which is why we would like targets in law for nature also. A positive element of the National Marine Plan was General Policy 9B, which was required that there should be no significant impact on the national status of priority marine features, which is a whole range of important species and habitats at sea. And it's that policy that triggered the main meaningful application of the plan from our perspective, which was following Scallop Dredger damaging flame shell beds in Outer Loch Carron. There was a policy commitment now 5 or more years ago to improve protection of priority marine features outside the MPA network. Forgive me, I just segued into another sort of policy ask that we have that's delayed.
Back to you, convener.
Thank you very much. Mark Ruscoe to be followed by Monica Lennon.
Thanks. I'd like to go back to a point that we discussed with the first panel, and that's about delivery plans. And I think the message I was kind of getting from the first panel was that they'd like to see the delivery plans effectively embedded in the strategy. Is that your position? Are you looking for more specificity in the strategy? Craig, do you want to kick off?
I would like to see more detail in there. If you look at the freshwater section, you know, it picks out beavers, it picks out salmon, and it picks out riparian woodland. What about all the other stuff that lives in freshwater? You know, to just pick out three species, is that all that they're going to cover? Is there a wider programme of species restoration in freshwater? There's just not the detail there. It says about significant, or I can't remember what the actual term is they use, but about significant improvements or significant restoration. What does significant mean? You know, is that we'll have another couple of salmon, or is it, you know, salmon across their expected range in Scotland? So yeah, I think for me, we need more detail in there. We need a little less vague. There's a lot of vague words in there that need a bit of definition, just so we can see what the level of ambition is.
Are you arguing then for the setting of a delivery plan first, say for freshwater or for marine, and then that to be built up into a strategy? Or
I think it
feels quite chicken and egg. So what would you like to see in a freshwater strategy then? A freshwater delivery plan.
What's missing is the targets from this document. If we knew what the target was, we'd know that it was, you know, the delivery plan would have to meet that target. At the moment, it's really quite vague. It's saying that helping species to naturally return to rivers. It's like, well, not all species can naturally return. Is that all we're going to do, or are we going to do the extra bits that are needed to help the species that can't naturally return? It doesn't, you know, cover some of our really important wildlife. It doesn't cover freshwater power mussels at all, aren't mentioned. We've got half the world's population in Scotland, and they're in decline. What are we going to do about it, you know? It's just the detail's not there. We don't have a... without the targets, we don't know where this is aiming for.
Okay.
So we don't know where.
So what are the key things you would wish to see for freshwater in a delivery plan? And I'll ask the same question to Callum.
I'd like to see a target, a plan for delivering natural flow processes in rivers. So removing the barriers to gravel movement and upstream movement of fish. Allowing rivers to use their floodplain. I'd like to see some targets for tackling non-native species. There's a huge number of non-native species, and many of them are in freshwater or along the banks of rivers. You know, there's a real thing that we can tackle there. I'd like to see the phasing out of peat use in horticulture. You know, it talks about restoring peat bogs. It doesn't actually talk about sorting the problem, which is that we're destroying peat bogs. So those are the sort of things that I'd like to see. I'd like to see action for species in there as well.
Yeah. Callum?
Thank you. Again, it's breaking it down into a bit more detail in terms of targets. It's like what does healthy mean for populations of whales, dolphins, sharks? But as I said in my submission, we should also be looking at other parts of the ecosystem as well, including some invertebrates. We need those. Just to reiterate what I said earlier, in terms of targets for the seabed and the pelagic habitat, we need to be looking at what does it mean to be healthy? What proportion of extant habitat does there need to be? And to have an understanding of that, we need to have a collective recognition of the very diminished condition of these habitats already, and that's accepted evidence. That's in Scotland's mean assessment. It's in equivalent UK assessment. So, just and from my experience, that's been a big part of the this rather contested space over the last few years. It's having an acceptance of that already diminished evidence base, and then collectively looking at that and thinking, well, where do we want to get to that tells us the seafloor is in a condition that can support other animals and plants, but also all the things that we enjoy from the sea in terms of food and blue carbon, of course. I haven't mentioned that. Carbon sequestration storage, and that's the other side of the nature emergency. So we need a bit more specificity on that to then have more meaningful discussions about percentages, because 37% of our sea is currently designated, but it's not necessarily protected from everything it needs to be within the MPA network. But we also need protection outside the MPA network. So it's having, if we don't have meaningful targets about where we want to go to, you can't have a discussion, because then it becomes, it's a motherhood and apple pie thing. Nobody can disagree. All the challenging discussions come about when you actually have a proposal in front of you, and we've seen that in bits of the sea in terms of MPA management measures, for example. We need to have these discussions at a regional sea scale, with an understanding of where we want to get to. And then the action plan has to be clear about how all the sectors have a role to play in wider society to get there across the sort of sectors that I mentioned. And I should quickly say that includes for pollution as well. Mm-hmm. I've sort of focused on extractive activities or activities on growing species, but pollution is a huge concern. Plankton numbers are plummeting, and plankton is the absolute fundamental base of the food web, and plankton provides half the air we breathe.
Yeah.
So there's a lot to do.
Indeed. And it is a concern here, again, just thinking back to what the first panel was saying, that previously we had a biodiversity strategy that was established, but there wasn't the delivery plans flowing from that to then actually act. I mean, has that been the issue up to now? So there's a concern that the strategy we set up looks great, and it's got some specifics in there, but the actual meat of the delivery can then just drift.
That I kind of touched on that in my first answer. That was my experience, certainly at sea, with earlier strategies, and to be fair, that's because they were happening in parallel, or the drafting of them was happening in parallel with recognition of need for new legislation. So we can deliver our aims for it through this new legislation and it being enacted, but we're now post-climate emergency. I would agree it's a nature emergency, which at sea is an ocean emergency, so we need... We can't have that drift, and it's important to emphasise the win-wins with this as well. This isn't about saying this to kind of, point the finger. It's about saying if we all want the services that nature provides, we can get our clean air, clean water. We can get our food, sustainable, local, resilient jobs and economies. But that foundation has to the state of the foundation has to be recognised as being diminished, and then we have to build on it.
Yeah. Final question. Do you think there's policy coherence within, say, a government organisation like Marine Scotland?
I think it's getting a lot better. So I think the Blue Economy Vision, the Future Fisheries Management Strategy, the Future Catching Policy, it's not quite joined up enough for us, I would say at the minute, but it's a lot less siloed than it was. But now it needs to be a case of getting on and delivering. So we look forward to that in terms of like the inshore cap. And that'll be a challenging process, but we need to be looking at how we use our sea space and if we're using it sustainably. So it's getting better. I think my view in it would have to wait until seeing the outcome of the future catching policy consultation, because as part of that we said we should look at review all fishing effort in the round and see what's the sustainable fit. And that principle should also apply for aquaculture, offshore renewables, any sector.
Craig, any reflections on policy coherence in freshwater before I hand back to the convener?
It's interesting that the River Basin Management Plan isn't mentioned in the biodiversity strategy, and that should be one of the mechanisms for delivering some change to fresh waters. That's just been published. That's for another 5 years. So within the time period of this first up to 2030, we're going to have to do another River Basin Management Plan. That really needs to be tied in. It really needs to look at what we need to do for rivers for the nature emergency, the climate crisis. For everything. I think the other thing to perhaps say is that on the marine side is that some of the problems in the marine environment start at the top of a hill, and what happens in that river on its way to the sea can influence conditions in the marine environment, in the coastal environment. So I think there needs to be that better link up between what's happening on land with what's happening in sea.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. Monica Lennon and then Jackie DeBar.
Thank you, Convener. My questions were about marine planning, but I think it's mostly been covered in the last session there. But if anyone's got anything they want to add, maybe come to Susan, who I can't see, but I believe is still with us. Susan, in the last session, I don't know if you heard that panel discussion, I asked about the recent outbreak of avian flu and the significant impact that's had on Scotland's wild bird population. In your view, what implications does this have for Scotland's biodiversity strategy? And I'll come to Susan first, and then come to Callum and Craig if they have anything to add.
Thank you. Yes, I mean, avian flu has sent an absolute shockwave through the conservation movement. I mean, globally, seabirds were already considered to be the most vulnerable group of birds that we have, and avian flu has shown just how susceptible they are to disease or to other pressures. And I think what it demonstrates to us is the importance of putting in place actions and measures at the regional level, as well as nationally, which help build resilience of our internationally important breeding seabirds. If we build some of that resilience, then they will be better able to stand some of the things which we are less able to directly control. And so, again, I think actually in terms of, turning improving the sort of strategy, making it more visible what the targets are that we're trying to achieve, giving a clear sense of the measures which might be required and levers required to implement those will be actually critical in taking us on the journey to, get change and to get change quickly.
Thank you, Susan. Would you like to give any examples of the actions or measures that you have in mind?
I think one of the critical things, and again, the draft seabird conservation strategy and the stakeholder engagement which has taken place on that, although the document hasn't come out to consultation yet, it really goes through a very thorough process of identifying the individual pressures on the breeding seabirds that we have, and then sets out some of the measures that will need to be addressed. And there are kind of a range of things, but you know, one of the critical pressures is around unsustainable fishery practices and also the need for biosecurity responses as well. So making sure that we've got some of those mechanisms in place, that they're properly funded when it comes to things like biosecurity responses for control of invasive species, I think will be critical.
That's helpful. Thank you, Susan. Callum or Craig, did you want to add to that? Yeah, Callum.
Yeah, quickly. Just on the planning, we've got even more delayed regional marine planning. Shetland's probably ahead of the curve on that. But and we responded to the committee inquiry on that, so we look forward to the result of that. But regional marine planning again needs resourced to deliver integration and recovery. On the avian flu crisis, you know, I bow to Susan and other seabird experts, but actually, you know, fully support the importance of delivering the seabird strategy and recognition in that strategy about, I mean, basically we've got a vicious circle of climate change, over-exploitation, pollution, and you know, there's this antagonistic effect. You know, unless we break that cycle, it's, you know, it's going down the plug hole. You know, so we need to have sustainable fishing practices. We need to stop the microplastics getting from the land. We need to stop the damaging forever chemicals. So that's something that might be in front of the committee. There's these chemicals, non-stick chemicals as well, that are they don't go away, and they can affect the entire food chain. And obviously the wider driver of climate change. So the best we can do is give these populations as much safe ground to nest on and as much food to go and feed, which means doing things like phasing out forage fisheries for sand eel and sprat, which the Scottish Government have made a welcome commitment to, for example. So. There's a lot to do.
Thank you, Cal. And just briefly, you mentioned resourcing in the context of marine planning. When you see that, do you also have in mind in terms of skills and workforce? Is there more that needs to be done in that area to make sure that we have, you know, the right people, the right training, the right skills to do these important jobs?
No, absolutely. There needs. I mean, I think, you know, I don't have the figures here, but there are some, you know, excellent. Marine and governance and planning courses in Scotland at our various universities and MASTS. Marine Alliance for Science and Technology Scotland does a great job of sort of coordinating that. But there might be a gap between these courses and getting enough skilled marine planners and people with an understanding within the regional marine planning systems and the local authorities and so on. Mm-hmm. So we that's definitely an issue. We do need.
Okay, well that's helpful. And I'll just come to Craig if you've got anything you want to add.
Just to echo what Callum and Susan have said about resilience. You know, it's about building resilience. I remember when I was younger, you know, disease in salmon, salmon coming into rivers that were diseased. Thankfully, that's not a case now, but you know, it could be around the corner. We've got non-native species that are coming into rivers, like pink salmon, in some of the rivers in the north. And we need to make sure that our biodiversity is as resilient as possible to all these things that are getting chucked at it.
Thank you.
Okay, Jack and DeBar.
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel, for coming along today. I think most of what I was wanting to ask you've probably already covered, so I'm going to go back to what I asked the original panel, if not the, the first panel, I beg your pardon, not getting my words out properly today. It's in regard to the National Environment Bill, which is due to be introduced in year three in Parliament. What legislative changes do you think are required to deliver the changes needed for our marine environment this time? If I can start maybe with Callum, Craig and then Sarah.
Yeah, so...
Susan, I beg your pardon.
Yeah. As I said in my written submission, you know, you've been hearing from all of us that this new legislation needs to have nature recovery targets across land and sea. Mm-hmm. So we'd be looking closely at the sea element of that. As I was saying earlier, in terms of, you know, how much of these habitats do we need? How much should we have? You know, the other thing that that bill can deliver is the powers to establish the committed to highly protected marine areas. So this is the welcome commitment in the Bute House Agreement for at least 10% of Scotland's seas to be highly protected, so protected from all extractive and damaging activity. So that would require new primary legislation. So that's a key thing that the Natural Environment Bill should have in it. I think I said in my written submission that, you know, there's other secondary legislation that we would need to address some of the things I'm raising in terms of fisheries instruments for the MPAs and so on, but they're not a requirement of the Natural Environment Bill.
Okay, thank you. Greg?
I just echo again the need for legally binding targets in the legislation so that we can, you know, make sure that we're actually doing this. The other thing, we should probably have a look at our non-native species legislation and see if there's more to be added to that. Particularly, you know, there's a EU regulation on invasive alien species, and just making sure that we're keeping pace with that.
You were saying about the legally binding targets. Do you have one in mind that you think, if you don't do anything else, then please do, you know, legally bind this one? Or is that maybe a bit of an unfair question to you?
I mean, I mentioned it right at the very start. You know, the EU biodiversity strategy has a target for restoring free-flowing rivers. I mean, I think that's something that we could look at putting into legislation, you know, that we've got to do that in the same way that, you know, we have climate targets. We have something for rivers in there as well.
Okay, thank you. And finally, Susan, and my apologies for getting your name wrong earlier.
Susan, can you hear us? We were wondering if you wanted to comment.
Targets. Yes, thank you. I would just echo the points about having very clear targets, that we have a clear sense of when we will report against those targets and milestones towards them, but also a clear sense of what activities and mechanisms need to be in place and the progress towards those as well. And Callum's already highlighted the lack of progress in relation to the development of marine regional plans. And I think, you know, when we look at the targets, we should also set some clear expectations around progress, around the mechanisms that will help us actually make the change that's required, and hold organisations accountable for those as well.
Thank you.
I'm going to have to bring this session to a close. Can I thank you very much for your expertise and knowledge and sharing that with us in what is obviously a very complex but challenging area. And particularly thank you to Susan for persevering with us, and we heard you loud and clear. Once the committee has considered how it best approach the biodiversity and nature emergency issue in relation to what we've heard, we will make a decision about what we do in terms of relaying that to the Scottish Government in our considerations and planning. So that concludes our public meeting, and we now move into private session, and thank you all.